crazy. Hey, not bad, not bad. I really like the morning, but how do you feel?
Six in the world. So don't
All good, Alaska. Do you need more room?
No.
Sure.
Parallèlement maintenant.
Absolument.
Ils ont perdu.
Ils ont perdu.
Faut plus parler.
Good morning. Thank you for coming to for the second day of the talk. I'll be sharing many fun guys because also Barbecue today. This morning and today we have several interesting talks at interdisciplinary side. My pleasure first to introduce Antonio Castro Neto, who's coming from Singapore. We work at the same institution, he's a director of Center for Advanced Materials, and he has been on the forefront of graphene research and discovery as well as the commercialization for many, many years from the beginning as a vehicle station. Thank you very much. Do I need a microphone? I think my voice is loud enough. Right? Okay. But I would like to have a slight shifter if there is one. There should be one somewhere over here. So I don't have to be tweaking. Okay. So, good morning. Thank you for coming so early. I'm sure you are all looking forward to go outside and enjoy this wonderful place and this wonderful weather. I want to thank the organizers for inviting me. My first time in Croatia,
And I'm so pleased to be here at such a beautiful place. And yesterday I was thinking what to talk about. I was looking over the talks and everything, and I talked to a few people that were here already. And I decided to switch from my original intention to talk about an overall picture of the materials, very general and so on. And I decided to go into something that is very specific. But given that today we're going to have several talks about microscopy and we're going to have talks on defects in materials, I want to talk about exactly that, defects in materials, but from the perspective of 2D materials. I think it might be interesting for a few people in this audience. So this slide is probably one of the oldest slides I have. It was produced in 2005, you know, in the very beginning of this field of 2D material. Graphene was very young and not very well known at the time. But we were already thinking about other materials beyond graphene. This is a paper written by Daniel Rossello and their colleagues in Manchester, which I believe is the most important paper that they wrote. It's not the graphene paper of 2004 that was published in Science. I think this is more important, you know, because it really it's the starting of this new view. Okay? Where they demonstrated in this paper that they could essentially exfoliate using scorching many different types of materials to atomic thickness. Right, so graphene, of course, was the first, and there are actually good reasons why graphene was the first. These other materials are not so easy to exfoliate as graphene. But once they realized they could get monatomic materials, monolayer, then they could put more effort in trying to get other materials as well. And the beauty of this is that all these materials here are very, very different from the chemical composition. They are very, very different from in terms of electronic properties. For instance, an niobium diselenide, it's a metal. It's a charged density wave material. It's a superconducting material. It has different many body phases in it. Well, of course, from graphite, graphene was extracted. Moly disulfide is a semiconductor. And now there is a huge class of semiconductors, and I'm going to be talking mostly about semiconductors today. I also thought about talking about superconductivity, but the time is not enough. Half an hour is not enough to cover everything. So I decided to talk about that. And of course, there is a huge number of layered oxides. High temperature cuprate is an example, but there are many, many other types of oxides, and actually can be exfoliated down to one atomic or of course not, you know, the unit cell of these materials is very large, so we're talking about one unit cell in the z direction of the crystal. Okay? And the interesting thing about all these materials is that these are not, you cannot describe them with a two-dimensional electron gas picture. These are not free electrons in a box, not even a two-dimensional box. Orbital physics is extremely important here. Most of these materials, they are made out of transition metals. So the electrons have to go through the orbital. And that means that the wave functions are very confined, and this enhances electron-electron and electron-phone interaction. So this is why you see many different many body phases, okay? Exactly because of that. All these materials are transparent because they're so thin. There is no other way. They have the highly non-trivial optical properties, and I'm going to talk a little bit about that in the context of semiconductors. All of them are soft, and this is one of the things I used to say in the very early days that what 2D materials bring now to the textbook is the encounter between soft condensed matter and hard condensed matter. You know, usually if you look at the textbooks in solid state, they are either in solid, in soft condensed matter, elasticity and so on, or hard condensed matter. You hardly see the two things coming together. But in this class of materials, this is unavoidable. Because as you stretch them, as you bend them, as you fold them, the electronic properties are coupled to the structural properties of the material. So graphene is a big example of that. So this is why you can tailor the electronic properties to strain. So there is a whole area in graphene research called strain engineering, where you can actually change electronic properties by just applying strain to this material. And I think that this is something which is more related to what I'm going to talk about. These materials are pure surfaces. They don't have a bulk. Okay, so the electronic states are exposed to the environment all the time. And because this brings good news and bad news. The good news is that you can functionalize them. So you can apply chemical reactions, change, add atoms, change atoms and things like that. On the other hand, the bad news is that when they are exposed to the environment, these materials become easy prey to oxygen. Okay, and as everybody here in the audience knows, oxygen is a good guy and a bad guy. It makes us alive, but makes us age and die. This is the same thing with this material. Okay, so oxygenation, it's a bad guy in this field. Okay, so we're fighting aging. One risk to see materials all the time because of that. So actually, one of the talks I like to give is about the use of 2D materials in space. Because I think this is really the place for 2D materials to go, because there is no oxygen there. And there 2D materials can survive forever. And no kidding, we are working on that. It's actually a beautiful area to work on. But for uses on Earth, or for study on Earth, this becomes an issue. So I'm going to talk a little bit about that. So there are many classes now, probably we know of thousands of 2D materials, mostly by computer simulations, we know. But so far, we have studied probably 20 or 30 of these materials. Part of the problem is related to synthesis and growing these materials and exfoliating them and so on. And part of the problem is that crystal growth used to be an art that got lost in time for several different reasons. You know, in the beginning of the 20th century and for a great part of the 20th century, crystal growth was something very important. But then, slowly, the good crystal growers disappear, you know? And for 2D materials now, this is what we need. We are at a stage that we need good synthesis and good materials to work with. So this is a challenge we have, okay, growing this material. So I'm going to talk a lot about a class of materials that has this structure here. This is black phosphorus, the structure of black phosphorus. It's just phosphorus atoms on this structure, very anisotropic structure. And this material can be exfoliated down to one monolayer. The monolayer is called phosphorine. It's a very interesting semiconductor. But this material is part of a bigger class of materials, which is called monocalcogenides. Okay, so there is a huge class of this. And these are examples of these materials, indium-5, germanium-5, germanium-selenide, tin-selenide. All this class of materials, they can be synthesized and they can be exfoliated to one layer structure. The beauty of this class of materials is that they can, you have a huge change, for instance, in band gaps. Some of these materials are direct band gap semiconductors. Others are indirect band gap semiconductors. And the range of gaps can go from the infrared to almost the ultraviolet. Okay, so essentially by changing the chemical composition, you can tune the gap by quite a large range. Okay, and this has many advantages from electronics perspective. Okay, so this class is very interesting. It's a very stable material, much more stable than phosphorine itself. So when we started working phosphorine in 2014, around 2014, we realized that phosphorine was very unstable to oxygenation. I'm going to talk about that. So defects, oxygen defects, have a huge impact in the physics of this material. However, these here are much more stable and have very, very interesting properties. So phosphorine, as I said, was one of the first to be exfoliated. It's, the mobilities are quite large for room temperature mobility, is around 1,000, okay, which is not bad. It's a direct band gap semiconductor, so it has a gap right in the center of the Brillouin zone, which is very interesting for optics. It's very anisotropic. This, you can see from the structure here that the crystal looks very, very different in different directions. So it has very interesting properties. And it's ductile, and you know, it can change shape. Okay? So there is, this is very interesting. And if you look, for instance, changing the number of layers, actually, you can go, you can change the gap within the bulk. The gap is rather small, it's a 0.3 electron volt gap. So if you have a bulk crystal or black phosphorus, but the monolayer, it can go to 1.2 electron volt. So by controlling the number of layers, you can actually change the value of the gap. And this is, now we have equipment that allows us to do exactly that. So we can make a material with one layer, two layers, three layers, four layers, etc. So we can choose the number of layers with atomic precision. And then, of course, we're talking about a different semiconductor because there's a different gap and therefore has different optical properties. That makes this material quite interesting. So one of the problems, early problems that we realized is that oxygen, as I was telling you, can be quite bad. And when you do numerical simulations, you see that there are many positions in the crystal lattice where the oxygen can sit. Okay? So oxygen can sit as dangling bond, as bridges, and so on and so forth. And depending on where the oxygen is, you can have almost no effect, which means that you have very shallow donor or acceptor states, or you can have very deep states in the middle of the gap. And this is the kind of thing you want to avoid, because as you start to produce these mid-gap states, your electronic conduction goes down. Right? So it's a quite important problem, but as I said before, we can do now numerical calculations and calculate, for instance, the binding energy of oxygen at different positions. And this is, for instance, not for phosphorine, it's for germanium sulfide. So again, this is all computer simulation. And by calculating divide the energy, we can find what's the most stable position for the oxygen. Right? So for, it's an interesting problem for microscopists, for us to understand, for instance, where is the oxygen sitting in the crystal lattice? But maybe this is a way for us to get better material. We get a better semiconductor. And what happens in this case here is that if when you test for this different class of monocalcogenide, you can see that the most stable configuration is a fringe type formation. So it's very similar to epoxy when you have in graphene, because you can have also epoxy groups in graphene. So it's actually very, very similar. But when you calculate the binding energy, you see that the binding energy for monocalcogenide is higher than in phosphorine. So which means that phosphorine is less stable than this material in terms of oxygenation. Okay, this is good news. Alright? Because most of the the only way we can work with this material in a lab is inside of a glove box, in an inert atmosphere. Okay, and for people who do this kind of job, you know how hard to do to work with these materials is. But this is very nice because then the properties, you can actually make very, very good devices out of this crystal. Okay, so this is one thing. But as I said, oxygen does not necessarily mean death. I mean, for instance, we have, this is also numerical simulations of different types of crystals you can get with oxygen. So there is a whole class of oxide of phosphorus that have not been synthesized yet. Okay, and this is our numerical simulation. And we find, for instance, that there are two-dimensional versions of this. There are one-dimensional versions of these crystals. So if we can control oxidation in a precise way, in a controlled way, we'll be able actually to make oxides of phosphorine, which are very interesting because the gaps can vary from around 1-2 electron volts to up to 8 electron volts. So these are excellent insulators. So instead of, if we can oxidize, for instance, one layer of phosphorine in a very good way, if this can be used as encapsulation already for the material which is inside. So technologically, this is very nice. Why? Because the way we do it today is that we have, what we do is that we go to the glove box, we exfoliate in the glove box, and then we take boron nitride, which is a 6 electron volt insulator, and we put on top. Okay? This process of putting on top, from the technological point of view, is very bad because the yield is very low. So if we find a way to oxidize the top layer of the phosphorine or the black phosphorus and just use that as the encapsulation layer, then we don't have to go through this transfer process, because this transfer process is the hard part. So I used to say that the most difficult thing of working with 2D materials has nothing to do with electronics. It has to do with the mechanics of dealing with a film which is just a few atoms thin. Okay, we don't have technology yet to do that with precision. Now some companies are starting to make machines that can transfer two-dimensional crystals on top of each other, but these are not fully automated. They have problems of orientation of crystals and so on and so forth. So there is still a technological issue for people working in this area of getting very good, reliable devices at high yield. Okay, so this is one of the challenges. Nevertheless, this boron nitride encapsulation works beautifully. When you do this, you really protect fostering crystal from the oxygen in the environment. And these devices become very, very stable. Another issue is that when you put a two-dimensional crystal on top of another two-dimensional crystal, you may be affecting the electronic properties of the material you're studying. This is why usually you need a very large gap material to be your encapsulation barrier. Okay, because then you separate the electronic states you are interested from the electronic states of the material you're putting on top. Okay. So sometimes this is STM studies done in Singapore of different types of defects. Even when you don't see oxygen, you have other elements hanging around. And this comes about because when these crystals are synthesized, there is unavoidable to have other elements there. Actually, for instance, these are STM pictures of two types of defects, S-like and a P-type. These are theoretical simulations based on hydrogenic models. But in reality, we don't know what these states are. We don't know what's creating those defects. We can, of course, write theoretical, little theoretical models that mimic what is going on there, but we don't know what it is. It could be a vacancy, it could be replacement of sulfur by selenium, could be many different things, and we don't know. So this issue of impurity defects in 2D semiconductors, which was a huge area in the 1960s, for instance, 1950s, 1960s, for semiconductor physics, is still a big issue now for 2D materials. So, for instance, this, what we have done is that intentionally adding atoms that we can control, and we look to see what happens. So this, for instance, we did experiments, this is from Barbara Rosino's lab, putting copper, so essentially sprinkling copper atoms on top of these materials, like phosphorus and so on, and look at the effect of in the electrical properties. So for instance, in this case, we find out that the copper binds to phosphorus in this kind of bridge way, and this leads to a shift in the band structure. Okay, so it dopes, but also the gap changes in the presence of copper. And when you look at the IDD, the conductivity of this material, you can actually see that happening in the transport. Okay. Then you can do something like you put something that which should be a little bit more trivial, which is an alkali atom, because you know that these atoms will ionize and donate electrons to the system very easily. But in reality, the effect of this alkali is not so simple. It leads to non-trivial band structure shifts, to big changes in the gap in the system by screening effects. And again, so this was done in Singapore. We looked at these different types of atoms, and we see that indeed, for 2D materials, even small concentrations of different types of atoms can have a big effect in the electronic properties. This is one of the consequences of going from three dimensions to two dimensions. For people who work in the field of low-dimensional materials, this is not a surprise. If you go to one dimension and you put atoms there, you are guaranteed to have huge effects. Because in a one-dimensional system, electrons cannot avoid the impurities. As you reduce the phase space for scattering, the impact of defects becomes bigger. And this is what we see in the experiment. So defect control is something that is going to be extremely important in this whole field. how to control defects, how to grow crystals which are very pure, very crystalline. You know, so this is still a big challenge, even in the graphene area. Although graphene is 14 years old, you know, we still do not have reliable growth of graphene to a level that we can use to build devices because of that. So another thing which is very interesting about this class of materials is that spin orbit interaction is very important. It becomes very important. And unlike three-dimensional semiconductors, actually instead of the valence band, they affect mostly the electron bands. So we have a lot of spin orbit coupling going on, and they have quite large values, almost reaching 100 millivolts. Okay? Which for normal materials is a huge number. 100 millivolts in solid state is a huge number. Okay? So, in fact, not only that, all these materials, because of the high anisotropy, these materials don't have inversion symmetry, crystal inversion symmetry. They can be piezoelectric. Okay, so you squeeze and you produce electricity. Okay, so you have, so the effect of pressure in these materials can lead to very, very interesting effects. So this is an example. And of course, one big area in this whole field in optics is excitons. So excitons, essentially, there are two types, like bunny excitons, which are big, fat excitons, and Fresnel excitons, which are very localized. And in this material, you can find both types, depending on what material you're talking about. Okay, so these are bound states. These are hydrogen atoms of electrons and holes produced by in the semiconductor. And so this is an example for two of these materials, germanium sulfide and germanium selenide. And one thing that we realize also is that usually for these materials, hydrogen-like models that we are used to in three-dimensional solid-state physics do not work well. And the reason for that is that, again, it's a phase space issue. As you constrain electrons to move in two dimensions, the Coulomb interaction between the electrons becomes highly modified. One way to visualize this is that if you have charged particles moving in a plane, the electric fields produced by these charges are transported in three dimensions. And outside the material, there is nothing to screen that Coulomb interaction. Okay, so there is very little dynamic screening going on in this material. So in the same way that impurities can have a big impact, the electron-electron interactions become very important. So when we realize that when we do numerical calculations for this material, it's very important to treat the Coulomb interaction in a serious way. So there is a big difference in doing, for instance, EFT calculations and doing GW calculations. GW is, for people who don't know, it's a way to incorporate in a bigger way the Coulomb interactions in the system. So DFT, normal DFT or LDA, does not take those interactions into account. And we see that you really have to go for the very heavy calculations for that. So this again is just showing the difference, for instance, in the optical absorption in different materials with GW and without GW. Okay, the differences are huge. Okay, to the point that you cannot describe the experiments if you don't do a serious GW calculation. Since I don't have a lot of time, so this is an example of in germanium sulfide, Fresnel exciton, and this is germanium selenide. So you change sulfur by selenium, and you get completely different types of exciton excitations in this material.
Okay, another thing, dielectric environment. Of course, you don't have these materials floating in space. You have them on top of a substrate. And these substrates are dielectrics. And these dielectrics contribute to the electron-electron interaction. So for instance, the binding energy in vacuum is completely different from the binding energy of the exciton in a silicon dioxide substrate. So I just want, I don't have time to go through the spin orbit coupling. I just want to conclude because my time is up. So what I'm trying to say here is that two-dimensional materials or two-dimensional crystals brings new challenges that we didn't resolve for 3D crystals. Okay, we solved this over a long period of time. Now we have a new playground, new challenges, new try to build new understanding about what happens for these materials. And I stress two important things here. One is defects, and another electron-electron interactions. Okay, and this is the way the field will evolve in the next few years. It's really trying to build more knowledge around that. Okay, with that, I want to thank you for your attention and for coming so early. Thank you.
Thank you very much. This is all the open for questions. How important is the epsilon interaction when we are talking about this?
It's the same. You know, again, electron form is electron fire. And the screening arguments I gave you for electron interaction work for electron ion. Okay, so with some of these materials, electron form interactions can be very strong. You know, and again, it depends on the material. So it's material dependent. So there is no like a general rule. You really have to go there and see, either experimentally or through numerical simulation. One of the biggest challenges here from the theoretical modeling perspective is that the game structure of this material is not simple. It's not like a thing that you can write down a very simple Hamiltonian and calculate tons of things and be awarded a Nobel Prize. This is not the case here. Okay, these materials require very serious numerical attack.
So, how? Okay, go ahead. Go ahead.
Yes. Well, we have a very good example in graphene, because in graphene, strain becomes a pseudo-magnetic field. It comes to the pseudo-spin of the electron, right? Obviously, you cannot generate real magnetic fields out of strain, because a magnetic field breaks time reversal symmetry. And there's no way to spontaneously break time reversal symmetry with strain. But you can create effects that mimic magnetic field. You can, well, spin orbit coupling will have an impact on the spin degrees of freedom, but again, you do not generate magnetism. For magnetism, you really need strong electron-electron interactions, and it's a different beast altogether. Yeah.
So, by the black phosphorus, how easy is this to engineer if you want to make a device?
Uh-huh.
Can you make a large area?
So this is another thing. So this is where I say that we have to nurture a new generation of scientists, young scientists who can actually grow these materials in a proper way. And as you know, crystal growth is not science, it's art, right? I always say that crystal growth, you have to be, it's for a certain class of individuals, not for everybody. But one of the problems with synthesis of these materials, especially in large areas, is that
a lot of time you have to use first very dangerous materials to start with. For instance, for phosphorine, you have to use phosphine. And phosphine was Adolf Hitler's favorite gas. Okay? So if you try to put a phosphine line in your lab, at least in Singapore, it's such a hassle to convince anyone to let use phosphine that essentially you cannot do it. You have to do it in an industrial setting. So many of the precursors of these materials are like that. The gases that you use are very poisonous. You have to be very careful with that. Okay, Slaven knows this. We have a big problem with borazine because Slaven is growing boronitride and the precursor is borazine. Borazine is also relatively poisonous gas. And there are all sorts of issues. And the other things that grows of these fumes is usually heterogeneous. So to grow single crystals is extremely hard. Even for graphene, people have not achieved the level of crystal growth that we would like. You know, since people grew graphene by CVD, we got stuck at 100 micron crystallized range. So we could not go beyond that yet.
Okay, I would suggest that we move forward and we can use the copy break the question. And just a quick few words of introduction. So Steve joined the NUS 2 years back. He's one of the pioneers in the field of ultrasound microscopy. He developed many, or he was on the forefront of development of many techniques that we are using nowadays, such as EOS and STM. And I will, with that, I will leave the stage to you.
Okay, well, thanks for that introduction. Glad I've become a Singaporean. Thanks very much to the organizers. It's really a pleasure to be back in Croatia. Always a beautiful place. So, as Tony has said, defects and materials are pretty much everything. So, I want to show you some stories about how, with the modern aberration corrected microscope, we can see into the material, we can see the defects, and then we can get the actual atomic analysis. So I'd like to start with just a brief history. Worth appreciating, it's the 80th birthday this year of the scanning transmission electron microscope, and that's what I'm going to talk to you about. It was invented by Manfred von Arden, 1938 in Germany. Now, you may not have heard about that because that didn't go very far, never became popular, and that's because it's so difficult to get enough current into a tiny beam to be useful. Albert Crewe is usually regarded as the father of the modern STEM, because he built a fuel emission gun and he actually got it working. The first person to actually see atoms in the electron microscope, and then we went through And for 20 years, we got a commercial version. But really, it's the aberration corrector that has changed everything. So by correcting the aberrations of the lenses, you can actually get maybe 100 times more current in a small probe. So that's what enabled everything possible. So let me show you. This is a picture taken by me before I had gray hair. 1989, this just shows you the regular TEM image, which was all they had back then, so take a look at the current structure. So this is a structure image. You can't distinguish germanium from silicon in the regular TEM image. But in the stem, with the annular dark field image, so-called Z contrast, or if you're American, a Z contrast image, now you get an image that depends on atomic number. Right? So you can either see the germanium on top of the silicon. So if you look hard, you can see more than that, because you can see each feature here is not actually round. See, it's distorted. and that's because there's two columns under each block, right? It's the famous dumbbell underneath. You can actually see that, even though we can't resolve it. So it's a very simple, directly interpretable image. Well, there's a lot of water under the bridge since Thursday, and so let's move straight to Singapore, NUS, and this is what brought me to NUS. We have a nice JOL, coal fuel emission down, which can run from 40 to 200 kilovolts. Revolution of sub-angstrom. We have a new corrector, which is the first commercial installation of the advanced stem corrector here. And this has really made this machine perform very well. So let me just show you 2D material. I'll introduce my students and postdoc, about you. So this picture, this is taken at just 40 kV. Now, you know about some of you, no doubt, SEM work at 30 kV typically. This is a stem that's working now at 40 kilovolts, and we get sub-angstrom information transfer. And this is all due to this aberration. So you can see all the detail in this Holly by Salamab. Jashu thinks it's awesome. I have to agree. Radon, now as Antonio said, which we really want to know in this material, the defects, and how do the defects correlate with properties. So this is Radon's thesis. He wants to have an automatic identification of the defects. Well, this is a slightly processed image. As you can see, just from the intensity, how you can immediately identify the defects. So the moly columns, or atoms rather, are coded in red. The Fe2s are in green. Now if you run along one of these green columns here, you'll see every so often there's a column that's about half as bright. Well, it doesn't take a genius to figure that it's half as bright as the selenium. But you can see, right? So now you can automatically identify all these selenium vacancies. And it's quite a lot. And what about this, black hole here? Pretty obviously, it's a dye vacancy, right? So it's very easy to identify all these pointy points. Now, the other one wants to, it's quite ambitious, which is good, we have good students in Singapore. It's not just the point defect that's important, you want to know its environment. What's it surrounded by? Its local configuration, because that's what determines electronic properties. Right? So he's come up with a very clever scheme. To determine the local environment. So here's an image of a piece of bilayer moly diselenide. And he can use this to identify the different point defect environments in this material. So here, for example, here's a diselenium column in the middle. He puts it through his algorithm, the Zernike polynomial, cleans up the image very nicely. And you get a signature in terms of the moments of all the different polynomials. These are all the different polynomials that he's kind of matching to the image. And so you can easily see here's a moly atom, you see how it's a different signature. Here's a single selenium, also has a very different signature from this one. So you can identify all these different local environments. It's very nice. And if you plot one moment, another, you can get a cluster. So you see all these different local environments. There's a lot more information in here than just whether you have one selenium or two seleniums, because it's looking at the environment. So the green one is in the 2R phase, or this region of the bilayer. And I think there's one along the edge here, and I can't quite see the color. Anyway, the point is, all these different local environments are probably very important for the optical properties. And with this technique, there's no training required. You don't have to know any knowledge beforehand. Automatically identify. So let me move to some materials applications. This is nanoporous polydiselenide.
I think the microphone maybe.
So, this is Matthew again. He's been growing these 2D materials under molybdenum-rich conditions. And is that better?
Alright,
great. So, this is MDE grown under molybdenum-rich conditions, and as you can see, it's a nanoporous cell, right? And interestingly, when you go to the graphene center and you measure the catalytic activity, you find it's actually very active, right? So there might be an evolution reaction. Now, of course, the question is, why? Can you figure it out? And, well, it's nanoporous, so it's reasonable to assume something to do with all these edge structures, right? It's about 1,000 times more edge density than in the CBD ground in the microscope. So you can identify all these different edges very easily in the microscope because we can see the atomic arrangement. And we see edges that you don't see in the CBD ground material. There's a couple of different edge structures, the experimental images, the DMT structures that are relaxed, simulated images, and you can see very good maps. The point is, we have some edges that are rich in undercoordinated molybdenum. And so, presumably, this is the origin of the new catalytic property. And so, you go to your friends who do the DFT, and they put it through, and they do their chemical reaction, and you find that these two new edge structures are, in fact, catalytically active. Right? These are the two edges in normal CBD growing material. And you go from hydrogen, go through the reaction, you really want no large activation barrier. See, if you go through this edge, you'll never jump over this barrier. This edge, you'll go this far, and then you'll never create the product. So these edges are confirmed to be highly active for HER reaction through the DFT. So it's through seeing the edges in the microscope that we know the structure. Now, Xiaoxu, he's a very, has another student, he's graduating next year, but you can't have him, he's going to do a photo. This is his library of different 2D materials. As Antonio said, they've always got some other elements with them. We don't often have monolayer metals, right? Why not? Metals like 3D bonding, so you wouldn't expect them to form a monolayer structure. But our microscope is still runs at 40 kilovolts. 40 kilovolts is enough energy to knock off the selenium. So, how about this? Why don't we use our beam to actually synthesize a monolayer metal? So, this is a Xiaoxu's result. You can see this region here has become monolayer membrane. And there are a few defects in there which you can identify just from the intensity and the simulation. So this is a movie, if you look up here, you can see as we scan the beam, you might be able to see this area is growing. This is the molecular membrane that's growing. These are 40 kilovolts, not high enough energy to displace the molybdenum, but it is enough to displace the molybdenum. And if you look at the different frames, you can identify the growth mechanism very easily. It's just the generation of this selenium vacancy, and the migration and the coalescence to form these triangular defects, and it becomes the metal monolayer. And if you really you can actually identify all the atomic steps involved in that from the movie. But I just want to show you this. This is Jardong again with his algorithm to identify the features. And you can see the selenium sites going down. This is the frame number of that video. Molly sites are assumption. But this one's interesting. He can distinguish the molecular science in the knowledge I sell up from the molecular science in the membrane, right? Because of these algorithms. You can really follow this evolution quantitatively. And if you get the conditions right, you can actually get some self-healing, right? The monolayers are actually in tension, so they do eventually tend to form holes. But if you gently spray them with the electron beam, so there's a lot of selenium moving around, you can get the holes to actually more or less fill up, self-healing. Now, piezoelectric introduced another very good student, Heinrich. He actually did a master's before coming to Singapore for his PhD, and he knows everything, almost everything, about piezoelectric. And I didn't realize that they were such useful material. But he's very passionate about these piezoelectric. Now, there's a slight problem with all of those applications, and it's because they all are based on lead, right? And we don't like lead, and it's not very good for your, for our health, so there's a huge effort to try and get the lead out. Now, working with some collaborators in this former group, the whole idea here is to try and engineer lead-free material with properties, good piezoelectric properties, at the room temperature, right? Operating temperature. Right? So this is real material science here. From the physics point of view, what we're trying to do is engineer the phase boundaries between all these different phases, right? Rhombohedral, orthorhombic, heptagonal, and cubic phases. What you want is to engineer a combination of different phases. Real material science, mix up these different elemental combinations to get this phase boundary at the right temperature range. And so actually you see here, this lead-free material does have properties, the interactive coefficient, it's pretty much comparable to these lead-based materials. What better than the previous lead-free material? It also has better temperature stability. And anyway, this, from the microscopy point of view, we want to know why. Why these materials have such a good problem. They put it in the microscope and you immediately see there's a hierarchical nanodomain oxygen. This is big stripes here, look inside the big stripes, the little stripes, and so you can start to, well, you can actually go and you can distinguish these different phases with this conversion beam. Fraction, you can see there's a coexistence of rhombohedral and tetragonal nanotwins, and you can kind of imagine how these might go together and form this four-rectangular structure. The idea is that all these phases have similar energies. It would be very easy to rotate the polarization, and that's what you need for good piezoelectric response. But it's a theory, right? Now, in our aberration-corrected microscope, we should be able to see this unit cell by unit cell, because we have the precision, well, we have the resolution for sure, but we also have the precision to distinguish intermediate motions like this. So, the fragmental phase, we should be seeing distortion this way, right? And on the knee, or off around it, there should be distortions along the diagonal. So, what we have to do is take a picture. So here's a picture. This is actually an annular bright field. We won't go into the details, but you can see the basic peroxide cell. The dark columns are the heavy ones. And this one in the middle is another cation, the lighter column. And these four here are oxygen columns. You can see all these atomic columns laid out in front of you. And the distortions are shown magnified by the yellow arrows. That's really very easy. You can see immediately that here they're all diagonal, right? Here they're all vertical. So you absolutely see laid out in front of you this hierarchical nanoscale phase mixture, right? A lot of even on the peptide phase. So, well, that was a tricritical point. Perhaps if we go one step further with a quadruple critical point, right? Add a few more elements here. Now we have four competing phases. Same idea, phase boundary engineering. For microscopy, again, we see coexistence of different phases. Computation, phase field simulation, it basically agrees. This is what we should be seeing. And this, here's electric coefficient feedback. Higher than many of the lead-based materials. So, yeah, we can actually do this phase boundary engineering, get the lead out of the material. Now, I just want to mention briefly some of the other materials we're working on. This is just to show how you can actually see single atoms in the real catalyst materials. These are cobalt atoms. Tungsten atoms on nanocrystalline cobalt phosphide. You can see them laid out here. This is cobalt catalyst atoms on the graphene oxide. You can see very nice, they don't form clusters, they're nicely bonded and dispersed on the graphene oxide. And the interesting thing here is that in the energy loss spectroscopy, you can actually see that these are bonded to oxygen. Because when you put the neon on one of these cobalt atoms, you can detect it in the energy loss spectroscopy. But you also see oxygen. And when you move the beam away, the cobalt disappears, the oxygen disappears as well. So now you know that the active site has to involve oxygen. So again, you know your theories, you can involve different possible active sites and understand the actual catalyst. Here's a few more. Isocarbide, platinum, covalent, covalent organic framework, gold, palladium. All very easy. Now, I just wanted to show you that we can do EDX. If you're used to EDX on an SEM, you might think about nanometer resolution. Well, on our machine, you get atomic resolution, you get chromium map, you get titanium map, you get columns of displaced as they should, on lanthanum aluminate, and you can really see the whole interface, chemical structure laid out in front of you. Really very powerful. You can actually detect individual atoms. Turned in, with a replay new color, with me. If you look at this spot here, number two, you can see it's a little bit brighter, and you can see a signature for lanthanum. Well, you can actually do a map, and again, like with the EDX, this is a calcium map, titanium map, oxygen map. And this, which looks like noise, is the lanthanum map. And if you superimpose them, you see it's not actually noise. You see this yellow feature. If I blow it up a little bit, you can see, well, it's not exactly yellow, a little bit yellow, corresponds to this brighter spot, which is where the heavy lanthanum is sitting. And if you look carefully, you'll see that a few other columns are looking a little bit yellow like. So maybe they have lanthanum, like this one. You can do an intensity trace there, you can see, yeah, this is brighter than the next one. This one is brighter as well. So actually you can detect these are single lanthanum dopants inside a 3D crystal of calcium titanium. So you have impressive, not just resolution, but sensitivity to single lanthanum. Okay, perfect. I want to just show you how we can actually see in three dimensions. Right? We have a focus beam, subangstrom resolution in the x-y direction, but it's also nanometer resolution in the z direction. Here we have a lanthanum aluminate substrate and a TiO2 film. John Gin didn't quite know that in microscopy we always put the substrate at the top. So this is the substrate, shot, and this is the film, and you see some spots down here. So this is some lanthanum that's diffused into the film from we change our focus, we should be able to see different depths inside the gun. This is a movie, we're going to change changing the focus, and we'll see these atoms. Atoms disappear, and these appear. This is a change of focus from top to bottom. And this is just a comparison, 3 nanometer focal step, we change from 50 like this, reducing focus. But notice too, that here we're seeing the first crystal. This is anaphase, no defect. You go 3.3 nanometers deeper, these lanterns pop up, but now you see we have a kind of a snapping top in the shift from the lattice from here to here. Yeah? So we're actually able to focus through and see three-dimensional structure of an extended defect. And that's just to show how we go from one to the other. Then we move on. Energy loss spectroscopy, we can confirm that they are actually lantern atoms. But I want to show you, introduce Charles Chom, who's a recent postdoc with me. He's very keen on computations and image simulation. And he produced this package using GPUs, which is much faster than any other package with Okidoki. And certainly it can handle a lot of atoms. This, I think, is the biggest, largest crystal model ever simulated for electromicroscopy. It was a benchmark, really, that is about 138,000 atoms, beautiful structure. And you see all the lanterns inserted in like this. This is exactly the focus. And actually, this is supposed to be a video. So this is the focal series, this is the experiment I showed you, and this is now the simulated image. Which is quite impressive. Actually, to simulate all these images of different focus depths. And this is just a comparison between the simulated and the experimental from this one. This is a perfect crystal, and this, I think, has a defect here. The color is not too good. This is supposed to show yellow, this is supposed to show red. But anyway. And so the idea in the future would be that we can refine these models and go around the loop and really try to get extended structure of these details. So I think that's everything. Yes, I can finish here. I'll just say how nice to be a Singaporean and very happy to have a very keen and enthusiastic action group in Singapore. So with that, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. I have two technical questions. The first one is all the images you show are taken at room temperature.
All at room temperature. We don't have any
cold stage.
Not yet.
Not yet. Yeah. But you plan to have one, I suppose, no?
We would like to have one. There's always an issue of stability.
Yeah. That's it.
When you can maintain this kind of resolution at low temperatures, it's pretty challenging.
Okay. And the second question is about the sample preparation. Because I think that behind all this beautiful work,
yes,
you have quite difficult sample preparation, no?
Very true. Sample preparation, for 2D, even for 2D materials, where they're already thin, trying to get rid of all the hydrocarbons that you've got to put on them, very challenging. Baking the samples.
And you cut with the FIB? FIB?
FIB with final cleaning at 2 kilovolts actually works very well. Uh-huh. So all the oxide thin films are just directly through the FIB.
Thank you.
Well, yes, I guess that's Hyman's PhD thesis right there. Can you put a bias on and actually see things moving? We have a biasing model, but we haven't quite, we're not able to answer your question directly. I mean, in principle, we should be able to see it moving, but it may move way too far. just an issue of, I think it should be possible. That's an experiment that I do before we graduate. Well, yeah. I mean, we can. So that's the Canadum's idea is that then you can set the microchip to basically scan an entire grid square, and it gives micron scale. And then you should be able to correlate with the optical properties that we can measure with a total thing. Yeah. Yeah, the change is optical properties. Well. Yes, definitely. They would change on the narrow, even at the atomic, near atomic level. Right? So the idea, that's why you really want to have a statistical, so you can build up a map of the population, different defects, with different treatments, you know, different parts of the sample, and then correlate it onto the measure. That's the point.
So, staying with the diglycogenides, I mean, you have a beautiful image of MOSC2. And you show that there are plenty of defects.
Plenty
of. Could we ever be able to make a good material for application?
Oh, well. Wow, that's a very good question. I don't know. Antonio, what do you reckon?
You know, the rule of thumb is that the more atoms you have in itself, the worse it is. Right? So this is why, I've been talking about the mono. Less atoms in itself, less possibility for disorder.
I think it's feasible. You know, if you know what defects are there, maybe you can think up a way to heal the defect.
Any last question? Any materials or any other causes you have to accomplish? Can you give me an intuition on this parameter? What type of materials growing more easily in this perspective?
Okay, well, I don't do the growth. I don't have much insight into that. I know that they grow on these materials, they grow on molten rocks. I'm sure that's absolutely right. Rocks and synthesis.
Appartient à leur marché là-bas en Asie, c'est très bien. Makes sense. C'est qui ce petit jeune?
C'est comme avec les études en RPE. Tu le vois tout de suite. Et... Le problème, c'est que c'est des communautés qui souvent s'ignorent. Il n'y a pas d'enrichissement. De...
Pourquoi?
First of all, I would like to thank the organizers, particularly last year and Blubber. The next question, which is related to the subject, for the incredibly long coherence time. They are organizing this series of conferences since 18 years by now. And I have to admit that at the beginning I used to make talks about the Bible, that is from solid state physics to biophysics. And I think that this just works whether the top pairs or half of the top pairs always has a good excuse to be on the beach. But when you try to work for solo, you start to infect your colleagues. So this is the first time that no longer I used to speak about one subject, about which I felt more or less half competent. At this time, I'm going to talk about two subjects, about which I'm sure that I'm less than partially competent. But half of the room knows more than you about one subject. The title was limited only to the NV subjects, and it made very the mechanism that I'm talking about is the complication. But before we go there, this is all the subject I would like to cover, and I'm sure that sooner or later I will be cut short of it. What are so special about the energy centers in diamond? So diamond, of course, in general, is a very, very valuable subject. But what is interesting for everybody, interesting nowadays for solid state physicists, is a very specific defect in it. There are many different defects on the diamond, which is naturally and particularly true in a lab, can be extremely few. But the isolated defects or Pollard centers were the subject of study since the 50s, probably. In the mid-90s, George Bachtel and his colleagues made the discovery that the Pollard center specifically made of the nitrogen, a substitution of nitrogen in the diamond, whose neighbor is a missing carbon atom or a carbon vacancy, has extraordinary properties. So what you have to imagine is that because of the missing carbon atom, there is basically four covalent bond which is missing, and for this four covalent bond, the three neighboring carbon gives three electrons, nitrogen gives two electrons, which is already five. If you add one more, then it's six electrons to put on the three orbitals. And the ground state of this two atomic molecule, let's call it in this way, is a triplet ground state with a quite sizable zero field splitting. And the amazing properties are slowly discovered over the last 30 years. Is that obviously this localized center, which is surrounded by a very large semiconductor, which is the diamond, the electron. Not only the ground state, but also the excited state is still within the gap. As a result of that, it acts as an isolated atom or a small isolated molecule, something similar than what the atomic physicists could show you. So the excited state turns out to be highly fluorescent, with a fluorescent lifetime of only 3 nanometers. I shouldn't turn my head. Okay. And as a result of that, thanks to the development of microscopy, the individual centers separated from each other are observable in the fluorescent microscope. The fluorescence is extremely stable, So sometimes it happens that somebody can write his good PhD on a single and be sent there.
But he's working on.
And what is important, obviously, there are many pathways to be taken from the excited state, but not all of them is progressing around in the 600 to 900 range, but there are so-called dark pathways whose specificity is that the plus minus one state, spin state, decays into the zero state. In other words, the fluorescence is sensitive to the spin state of the non-state. Also, the consequence of this, not only that the fluorescence carries an information about the spin polarization of the non-state, that if you repeatedly generate fluorescence transitions, the ground state is becoming spin polarized, vertically 100% in the zero state. So what this means that we are basically able to do kind of atomic physics in a solid. And because of the spin polarization, basically you are effectively working at low temperature. So what this means in reality, that you are able to observe a single NV center. And if the environment is perfect enough, that means you get a beautiful monocrystal that you didn't, for example, all the carbon 13. And all the other impurities, then you are able to do electron spin resonance of the ground state, observing the fluorescence of your single center. And it turns out that this ground state, the spin states of the ground state, have an extraordinary low coherence time, which can be up to several milliseconds at room temperature. This long coherence time, of course, inspired many potential applications, including quantum computing, where, of course, the fundamental issue after that, so this is nice that I have one qubit here, but how am I going to put and organize my life for the second one, and how do I control where and how do they relate to each other? The other interesting application sets are coming from the simple fact that these low energy transitions between the zero and the one state are obviously extremely sensitive to external field. After all, we are doing optically detected electron spin resonance, so naturally, you can measure magnetic field with it. But with such a long coherence time, it means that this magnetic field measurement is becoming extremely sensitive, so it can be a non-Tesla approach. Because this is a complex orbital, of zero to large zero field splitting, it is also sensitive to the electric field, it is also sensitive to the lattice deformation. So practically, locally, you can measure all kinds of fields. You can measure strains, you can measure electric field, you can measure magnetic field. Obviously, the real advantage is that this is a extreme localized scale, at atomic scale, you can make high precision measurements. It is also clear, of course, that the high precision localized is related to the high localization and separation from the rest of the universe. What it means, for example, that the simplest measurements we can do, that we measure, for example, the generate fluorescence for a certain time, which will result in a 100% spin polarized state. And then you measure the fluorescence intensity, which is going to show you that you are in a 100% spin polarized state, and you repolarize it again. And as a result of that, if you change the measurement time, you can measure the relaxation time of your spin state optically. And this relaxation time is obviously extremely sensitive to the environment. So simply moving a gadolinium tip close to the MV center that you are observing will reduce the relaxation time and the lifetime orders of magnitude, which is the simplest proof that this can be an extraordinary sensitive water probe. And I believe that everybody in the room who's in solid state physics part knows and heard about this many, many times. This of course also means that if I now measure fluorescence, for example, at this relaxation time, at a fixed time delay, then I can make a simple imaging device by using an NV center, by using a bunch of NV centers in a certain distance from the surface, and putting gadolinium pads on the surface. Because under the gadolinium pad, the relaxation time is much reduced, while away from it, the relaxation times will become slower. So the imaging ability, the measurement ability of the NV centers were obviously demonstrated in many different ingenious ways. And obviously locally it is far more sensitive than having the magnetic field of a patch of gadolinium. The only issue is that how to make sure that you have an intimate relation between an NV center and the object that you want to measure. One practical thing is, for example, to use very small diamonds, non diamond crystals, where you can assume that practically all the NV centers are relatively close to the surface, and then cover the surface with the various material which can influence the relaxation times of the NV center. One possibility, of course, that you are putting some biomolecules on it and moving on the biomolecules as spin ladle more or less close to it. Here, the trick was simply putting a single stranded DNA molecule on it, and then the other half, the DNA, was spin labeled, and you could change in this way the distance of the molecule. This showed already distinct spectroscopical differences. Not everything is perfect in the diamond, because obviously it's difficult to control the existence of the NVs and where they are. And one of the issues that obviously the properties are dependent on the orientation of the NV center. They are all in the 1-1-1 direction. And that means that in an orbitary orientation, there is 4 different orientations around. So if you put a finite magnetic field, you immediately swim as splitting to 8 different lines. Hence, you can either choose to work in zero field, or you are going to be limited in the ability of how to use them. So what use can be there? And I would like to start to motivate the biological use and try to tell you a few words about what is proteomics, which is probably I am the least person in this room to explain the proposition. But this is my humble understanding. In about 1986, the work with genomics was generated, and the purpose of the project was to decode the human genome. And I think this is practically achieved. It gave a head start for personalized medicine, but it also soon got understood that having the genetic code is not exactly 100% information about the state of health of somebody. We all carry various genetic codes of all kinds of sicknesses, but we not likely or not necessarily developing and showing the symptoms. In other words, part of the code is not active. So, as all the biology research is basically motivated by health issues, if I want to be a realist about it, the next flagship project, the Proton, was generated in 1995, saying that the different proteins which are produced by the different living cells in your body are the ones which are a better measure of the kind of genetic code which is really truly expressed in your body. So it's more representative of your health state than what kind of proteins are in you, than what kind of genetic codes you are carrying. The unfortunate case is that it is estimated that there is about 25,000 different proteins in the human body. This is only chemical differences. Every one of them can potentially have 3 to 30 different forms. So it is obviously a quite long project to try to map out the different proteins. Where should I put it?
I think the cable is unplugged. Yeah, it's like scratching.
Switch it off.
Okay.
Very sure.
It's probably the battery.
So it's a large number of proteins which can be produced in your body by the different cells which are living, which are currently functioning in it. And it's quite an ambitious plan to try to map them all out. But biologists are extremely innovative. And at one point, originally, different tests were produced by developing antigens in sheep for all kinds of other ways. But in the early 90s, the molecules, synthetic antigens, appeared basically made out of nucleotides, finite chains of single-stranded DNAs, which were specifically developed and selected for binding only a given protein. And later, variants of them, small of the modified aptamers, were developed by this gentleman, very old, who also founded a company, Somalogy, with the completely express purpose of trying to test for all possible human proteins. He was the inventor of this process, which is called Celex, which basically takes a random set of RNA molecules and selects and develops in several steps for binding specifically to one. one molecule. Having said that, specifically binding molecule is not yet a measurement. This is just something which has to be transformed to a concentration measurement. The company currently is able to test in 9,000 protein. The 9,000 protein, of course, is limited by that this is about how many proteins have been ever separated until now. But as more and more are separated, there will be hopefully more to come. The test cost is what is a limiting factor, because basically the material, the way how it is separated is a fairly well-run chemistry, but it ends up on a test plate where the measurement finally done all of these molecules, and after the test, this test plate is going to be thrown up. So it would be important to make a reusable assay, which the 9,000 after the 9,000 proteins tested on it could be washed off and reused, hopefully by every one of us individually, almost every day. So the company hired Jason Friedman, who you probably know, or some of you know, he was once upon a time the founder of the Simon Museum, with the explicit mission that he has to find a way to build an instrument which would be able to test for these 9,000 or more proteins, and then this test could be reused. So the assay, for example, could be installed in your home. You could use it regularly, and the data would be collected because of the simple reason that there is no medical doctor who is interested to know 9,000 number. Instead of the 9,000 number, they would like to have some more correlated answers that how the protein sets of your body is changing and how your health is changing as a result of that. So, to put together the two sides of the story, one of the technologies which come to mind to be able to respond to this need would be the nitrogen vacancies. In other words, if you are able to make nitrogen vacancies in a controlled distance from the surface, and if you are able to bind these solar molecules to the diamond surface, this will, of course, open up the possibility that the solomers are not going to disappear. We can reuse them because they are covalently bound on the surface. When they bind the protein, although only a limited number of structures is known, everybody believes that there is a conformal change of the shape of the molecule. As a result of that, at least part of the molecule will come closer or farther potentially to an NV center or to the surface. So the hope is that this binding process is going to be, one will be able to turn into a simple on-off detection, and if large number of these kind of molecular detections are made, you will be able to transform this to concentration number for one given protein. Obviously, the idea is that now you can topologically separate the different proteins, and on the same surface, hopefully you can test more than one, potentially 10,000 protein at the same time. Can I tell you that this is a nice thing? That nice dreams sometimes can be followed up. There is a vast effort made to control where to put the NV centers into the diamond, which are typically grown in CBD chambers. And there are many ways to see that, for example, you can grow clean diamonds, then you can grow a narrow layer where nitrogen impurities are quite concentrated, and then you should be able to continue this with a thin layer of fluid diamond, this could be still not NV-centered, it could be still only nitrogen, but it is known that if you make some irradiation damage, generating some vacancies around, and then you NV the sample, the vacancies are going to be somewhat mobile, and they tend to migrate and merge to the nitrogen, and that would be one possible way to generate at least most of the NV centers being the same distance from the surface. And another more controlled way is to use nitrogen implantation. And accidentally, the CVD growers are also able to control not only the nitrogen, but also the NV center concentration during the growth. As you can see here in this set of experiments, I'm going to stop in a second. Also, the diamond can be grown in different directions. The 111 direction growth would be far more advantageous from the measurement point of view, because all of this point would be the same. And it appears that under certain conditions, when the 111 direction diamond is grown, the NV centers are all oriented perfectly parallel with the normal of the surface. So, needless to say, that I consider that this is a challenge project where there is sufficient challenge in both sides of the diamond. Not only under the diamond, but how to get the nitrogen, the empty centers close to the surface, but on the other side, to build the molecular sensors, the biological molecular sensors, in such a way that it makes sure that all the other influences related to the surface are not dominating the responses of the NV centers, but the simple capture and release of the protein is going to be a measurable signal. I guess I thought more about the challenge of the quantum electrological use of the NV centers for biological purposes than solutions, but the advantage of this kind of conferences, but Laszlo and Gabor organized, that hopefully after this talk I'm going to have many advices from both sides of the surface of the diamond, both from the biological and from the species part. Thank you very much. The short answer is that yes. The longer answer is that there are zillions of applications of the NV centers, but I all ignore. They all suffer of the same common problem. That is, they were all demonstrated on a single NV center measurement. Okay? Which means that in any diamond, you will be able to always find one NV center which is in the right location for a protein, or it's the right location for to the surface to measure something. The problem is how to scale it up that you measure many and you are able to get a statistically significant number. It is extremely useful to make single molecule experiments,
but it's difficult to make them in a useful way when you get a macroscopic number. And this is the challenge of making the ND centers. Once you have a surface of diamond with a control distance ND centers, you can use to study the proteins or the dynamics of the molecules. You can, people have plans to use it for dynamical nuclear polarization, that is polarizing the nuclear polarizing the various nucleus in the molecule, which is nearby, which is washed on the surface. This is probably an accidental choice that I was talking about this application, but all those applications which are hinted in the literature and heralded as a breakthrough are depending on how the ND centers are going to be reproducibly placed in the diamond and how you can turn this now to a reproducible study.
Also, I